today is just to meet on this side here, just using these two sections instead of going across. And we'll again pass the mic. Let's just open in prayer, and we encourage everybody in the foyer to make their way in. Maybe there's donuts in here, we should say. Maybe, but maybe not. Let's pray together. Lord, we thank you for this morning, and we thank you for each one that's here and will be with us. We pray that you will bless our time of study and discussion and learning, and help us to, by your grace, put things into practice in our life. We want to be thankful people in the true sense and live in that way and speak in that way. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, when you come in, there should be a handout for you. And we're just trying to use this side here today. And I think we'll try to use that each Sunday, actually. And then we'll try to pass our mics. We may need extra mics. We only have two at the moment. But we're looking at Psalms, praise and prayer. And we're just meeting on this side. We're looking at Psalms, praise and prayer. And we're looking at it over the next 18 weeks or less. And we're looking at it in six sections, six types of psalms. And each psalm or type we'll spend three Sundays on, or three psalms in that type of psalm. So we have had two Sundays looking at some Thanksgiving psalms. There are many more than what we're looking at, but we looked at Psalm 100 and at 107, and today we'll look at Psalm 136. And the object of this is, I'll try to do a little teaching, but we want to have some good discussion, and we want to seek the Lord to understand what the text says and how it applies to our personal lives and how we can be thankful people in the true sense. The bottom line of the question that we're asking is, what really is biblical thanksgiving? It's spoken of very much in Scripture. And what really is thanksgiving? So this morning I've asked our college and career, some of them, to be readers. And what we're going to do is, we have the two mics, so we're going to kind of move them around between me and them. And anyone who wants to ask a question or comment, just kind of indicate with your hand and we'll get the mic over you quickly, just so we can hear. We have some of us speak quieter, others of us have a little harder time hearing. And so don't feel intimidated by this mic at all. But we're going to just meet on this side over the next Sundays, whenever we meet, and try to make this personal. And we have seen, as we've seen, thanksgiving or giving of thanks is really an offering of thanks. Think of it with the word offering. Giving or offering of thanks. And we didn't have a lot of time, and that wasn't the point, but we looked a little bit at Leviticus 2, 3, and 7. Chapter 2 of Leviticus speaks about a thanksgiving offering, and chapter 7 combines it with a peace offering. So that is the basis. And when we come to Psalms, we see comments about the temple, the tabernacle, offerings. And in the New Testament, we see that this is fulfilled in Christ, and as believers, we are to be a people that offer up thanksgiving. And so we're going to read a few passages of Scripture. And Shailene, if you want to start with Psalm 96, verse 2. And then I've asked Lucas to have Hebrews 13, verse 15. And then if Lars, if you want to find Psalm 116, verse 14. and then verse 17 to 19. So we'll start, 116, verse 14, and then 17 to 19. So Shailene, if you want to begin.
Psalm 96, verse 2. Sing to the Lord, praise his name, proclaim his salvation day after day.
Through him, then, let us continually offer up a sacrifice of praise to God, that is, the fruit of lips that acknowledge his name.
I will fulfill my vows to the Lord before all his people. I will present a thank offering to you and call in the name of the Lord. I will fulfill my vows to the Lord before all his people. In the courts of the Lord's temple, in your midst, O Jerusalem, praise the Lord.
Now what we'll do is, Peter, could I get you just to take this? Maybe we'll keep this one out there and we'll share this one.
Thanks.
If I can have a mic for a sec. The passages that were read are Psalm 96, verse 2. I don't know if they're on your paper. Psalm 96, verse 2, Hebrews 13, verse 15, and Psalm 116, verse 14, and 17 to 19. And they just say some things in light of thanksgiving. Did you catch chapter 96, verse 2? Maybe what's one of the emphases in there? Shailene, if you want to read it again.
Sing to the Lord, praise his name, proclaim his salvation day after day.
Okay, what did you catch it there? What can you learn about thanksgiving? Okay, that's it. So if we're looking at biblical thanksgiving, what is really biblical thanksgiving? It's a daily thing. Okay? Lucas, he read Hebrews 13, verse 15.
Through him, then, let us continually offer up a sacrifice of praise to God, that is, the fruit of lips that acknowledge his name.
What can you see there? It uses the word offering, doesn't it? What can you learn about thanksgiving in that?
It's continual.
Okay, it's continual. And remember the basis about the thanksgiving offering and the offerings in the temple. They were continual, all day, every day. Anything else in Hebrews?
It's our declaration, the fruit of our lips, giving thanks to his name.
That's good. The fruit of our lips, giving thanks to his name. So it's a testimony, isn't it? So it's not just kind of thanks for the meal, which is okay to say, but what should we be doing daily? The fruit of our lips that testify to him. Actually, one thing about the tithe is that the tithe represents the whole, and the tithe says this: everything comes from God, and I give this memorial piece to God representing the whole. So everything comes from God, everything I give to God. Okay, and Lars read, if you want to just read it again. Yeah, 116, verse 14, yep. And 17 to 19.
I will fulfill my vows to the Lord before all his people. I will present a thank offering to you and call on the name of the Lord. I will fulfill my vows to the Lord to all his people. In the courts of the Lord's temple, in your midst, O Jerusalem, praise the Lord.
Anything there about thanksgiving you can learn? What's repeated there? It's continual, it's a testimony, and in here we see
it's everywhere.
It's everywhere. Okay. Everywhere we go. Anything else? What does the psalmist really want to do? And he emphasizes that.
Fulfill.
Yeah, he wants to fulfill it where?
In the temple.
Okay. So biblical thanksgiving is that God's people desire to declare God's goodness to them in the presence of the people. Do we come here on Sundays overflowing with praise and thanksgiving to God, and we just can't wait to get here so that we can make a declaration with the fruit of our lips before the people of God? And what does that practically do then, if we're doing it daily, if we're doing it continually, if we're doing it as a testimony, if we're doing it in front of all the people? What are some practical things that would result? Okay, humility. Would it have an effect on the people? Say we got together, and do we do this if we, let's say, we have a church potluck around the table? I can hardly wait, not for the potluck, but that I can declare with the fruit of my lips the goodness of God to me, to the people around the table, to the people. And what will happen? Yeah. Fellowship, unity. What is fellowship? Is it just people sitting around eating food? Or two people together in a ship? Fellowship. People of like mind. And whose mind are we want here? Christ's mind. It's enjoying and participating with Christ together. And thanksgiving is a very strong characteristic of that. That instead of grumbling and, boy, the weather is awful and this didn't work and that didn't work around the tables, I can hardly wait to live. And who's at the center of all this? Christ. Not me, but I can hardly wait to declare the Lord in the presence of his people. Anyway, let's go to Psalm 136. So if you find Psalm 136, now, how many have read Psalm 36 in your lifetime? Do you find it an easy psalm to read? It can look difficult. And maybe in the back of your mind, why do I have to keep saying your loving kindness is everlasting? Every part sentence, at the end of every, in fact, it's said 26 times in 26 verses. And in a sense, it's kind of hard. Why don't we just cut it and read the storyline and say it at the end? Maybe say it at the beginning and say it at the end, but let's just not interrupt the story, the testimony here. So what we're going to do is if these wonderful people can read Psalm 136, you can just take turns, but every time you get to "for his loving kindness is everlasting," just stop. And when you stop, the rest of us will say it. Okay? So what the rest of us say is, "for his loving kindness is everlasting." That's all you have to remember. So if you want to start reading, Shaylin, and you know there's 26 verses, so kind of divide it by three. And
give thanks to the Lord, for he is good.
For his... Okay, that's a try. Next one.
Give thanks to the God of gods. Give thanks to the Lord of lords. To him who alone does great wonders. who by his understanding made the heavens.
Okay, we'll give it a big shot this time.
Who spread out the earth upon the waters. Who made the great lights. The sun to govern the day. The moon and stars to govern the night.
To the one who struck down the firstborn of Egypt for his royal... Oh, sorry. Go ahead. And led Israel out from their midst. With a strong hand and an outstretched arm.
Loving kindness.
To the one who divided the Red Sea in two.
For his loving kindness is everlasting.
And led Israel through its midst.
For his loving kindness is everlasting.
And tossed Pharaoh and his army into the Red Sea.
For his loving kindness.
To the one who led his people through the wilderness.
For his loving kindness is everlasting.
To the one who struck down great kings.
And killed mighty kings.
For his loving kindness is everlasting.
Sihon, king of the Amorites. And Og, king of Bashan.
For his loving kindness is everlasting.
And gave their land as a heritage.
For his loving kindness is everlasting.
A heritage to Israel, his servant.
For his loving kindness is everlasting.
It is he who remembered us in our low estate.
For his loving kindness is everlasting.
And rescued us from our foes.
For his loving kindness is everlasting.
He who gives food to all flesh.
For his loving kindness.
Give thanks to the God of heaven.
For his loving kindness is it. Now who got tired about that one? Really, honestly. Now you can imagine if you were to go into the tabernacle courtyard, temple courtyard, and this was being done as the priest probably would speak and the people would respond. Can you imagine, let's say, if you go to Israel and you're in front of the Western Wall and it's the whole court is filled of 100,000, 200,000 people and they're all saying this in Hebrew. Can you imagine during the time of Ezra and Nehemiah when they were divided into two groups and one group went on this side and the other group on that side? Can you imagine them at the Red Sea when they sang? Can you imagine them at different feasts and festivals? Crowds of people. Unfortunately, many didn't understand who the Messiah was and their need and didn't want to admit it. But why is this matter of loving kindness? First, what is loving kindness? What is it and why is it so important? And why is it said 26 times in this song? What is loving kindness? Maybe your translation says another word for it.
Christ says, for his steadfast love endures forever.
For his steadfast love endures forever. Anybody else? Mercy. Okay, that's one translation that uses mercy or mercies. Like his, go ahead.
For his loyal love endures.
His loyal love endures. Anybody else? Loving kindness. Steadfast love, loyal love, emphasizing loyal, steadfast, mercies. Now, this is God's covenant love with his people. The Old Testament, we see it, his covenant love with his covenant people. They'd entered into a covenant at Mount Sinai. And this is his covenant love. Now, if we see in the same chapter, verse 1, we see the name of God. What does the very first verse say? Just the first part. Okay, give thanks to the Lord. Now, what name of God is being used there when it says, give thanks to the Lord. Okay, it's Lord. Sorry.
All in
capitals, which means what title? That's the translators used a code. Okay, sometimes Lord was all in capitals, sometimes it was capital L and then small letters. And this one is, when it's all in capitals, it's Yahweh or Jehovah. And so you think of what that means. And one thing amongst being the provider, being self-existent, is his covenant name. So Yahweh and loving kindness, you have the covenant name of the Lord and the covenant love of the Lord for his covenant people. Okay, that's really important. And so we're seeing this matter of covenant. And this name, Lord, or Yahweh, is the key name used through here. There's some other ones. Verse 2, we have the word God of gods, Elohim. But there were many Elohims in the pagan nations. And Yahweh is the Elohim of Elohims. We'll get back to that in a minute. There's also verse 3. What does it say? Give thanks to the Lord of Lords. Now, that is capital L, small O, small R, small D. Not Yahweh, but Adonai. Plural, which speaks of the Lord, the Master, majestic, sovereign. And the context is that Yahweh is the Elohim of Elohims. Yahweh is the Master, the sovereign, the majestic one of all the Lords. He is the Lord. He is God. We'll come back to that in a minute, but we have his covenant name, his covenant love, and his to his covenant people. And now, loving kindness is used 26 times. Why is it used 26 times? Why is it through, you know, you read a part sentence, you don't read the whole sentence, for his loving kindness is everlasting. You read a few words, his loving, and you go back and forth. Why? What do you think that's saying? Yeah. Okay, that's very clear because that's at the end. But that's very good. His loving kindness endures forever. It's not for a day, right? It's forever. And something else is that what? About. Why is it every few words? Not just forever, but, you know, they're going through all this storyline. We'll get back to the storyline in a second. So everything is from him. He controls everything. He is everything to us. So his do you realize what it's saying is that his loving kindness is involved in every breath of your life if you're a covenant person? He never stops loving you. And he's loving you all the time through the good times, through the hard times, through the easy times. He's loving you all the time and he never stops loving you. And he never stops working in you, whether you're going through the Red Sea, whether you're in Egypt, whether you're going through the desert, whether you're here or whether you're there, whether you're asleep or not, whether you wake up with a headache or whether you wake up feeling like you could run 20 miles, whether you're in the hospital or at home, whether people like you or don't like you, he never stops loving you. That's the point. And the point is that it's trying to say, get it, get it, get it. So then we have this storyline. So if we read, our readers can read, let's follow them quickly. Let's skip all the loving kindness of God verses, parts, and just read the storyline. But we remember the covenant God, his covenant name, and his covenant love to his covenant people. So let's start again, Shailene. Start reading in verse... verse 4. And we'll skip all the loving kindness verses. So just read the storyline.
To him who alone does great wonders, who by his understanding made the heavens, who spread out the earth upon the waters, who made the great lights, the sun to govern the day, the moon and stars to govern the night.
To the one who struck down the firstborn of Egypt and led Israel out of their midst with a strong hand and an outstretched arm, to the one who divided the Red Sea in two and led Israel through its midst and tossed Pharaoh and his many armies into the sea, to the one who led his people through the wilderness, to the one who struck down great kings
and killed mighty kings, Sihon, king of the Amorites, and Og, king of Bashan, and gave their land as a heritage to Israel, his servant. It is he who remembered us in our low estate and rescued us from our foes. He who gives food to all flesh, give thanks to the God of heaven.
Okay, there's the storyline. That was easy to follow. But it's saying that the covenant God never stops loving his covenant people in all the storyline, in all your storyline. Okay, now notice that this storyline comes in sections, doesn't it? What's the first section? Start at verse 4. To verse 9 is creation, isn't it? So we're going right back to when there was nothing and God said, let there be. And how in the world... And then it speaks about creation, him creating certain aspects of it. But the loving kindness is all mixed up in the creation, isn't it? His creating. What practical truths can you learn from that? See, we're his creation. We're living in his creation. The heavens, the earth, the sun, moon, stars. You look up at night. It's nice to see the sun shining. How does that involve, what's that saying to me, to you?
How awesome God is.
How awesome God is. And you're seeing it in creation. So he was thinking about you. Do you think so? He was thinking about you before the world existed, and he made this world for you. Are you for this world? He made this world for you, she's saying. Anything else?
Can you read through all of this? And I think it's consistent with God.
Okay, that's good. Anybody else? Now this is important, the word verse 4 says alone. That's good for anybody who believes in evolution or other things to realize that Yahweh alone. Nobody else, he didn't need any help, right? He's the only one, he did it. Only him. He made it. He sustains it. He's sovereign over it. Great wonders. And then it describes them. Now, going back for a second to verse, and that can relate here, verse 2. What is meant? Give thanks to the God of gods. Is that saying that God is the head of the gods? God is one of the gods? What's that saying? Does that sound a little confusing to you? Or what is God saying there?
He would be saying that there is only one God, the I am.
Yeah. Only one God, it's saying. I am. The Bible doesn't close its eyes to the fact that the pagan nations and the peoples of this world then and today worship all kinds of gods, and that's in small g's, a small g, does it? And 1 Corinthians tells us that these gods are idols, and really they're demons. So they're worshiping demons. But God is God. And it speaks a lot about these small g gods in Scripture. They have eyes they don't see, they have ears they don't hear, they, you know. And those who worship them will become like them. But I am the true God. Okay. Who alone does wonders. Okay, look at verse 10. There's another section. Verse 10 to 15, what's that? How would you summarize that?
Deliverance.
Deliverance, that's a good word. Egypt, Red Sea, deliverance. So God is the deliverer, the redeemer, the savior. Verse 16 to 22 is another area. How would you summarize that? Now, there, where are they in those verses? They're in the... came out of Egypt,
they're in the wilderness.
Yeah.
And they're wandering because of their sin.
Yeah.
So that's really cool to realize that God still had kindness for them even when they were not being obedient.
Okay. They disobeyed at Kadesh Barnea, they're wandering. Sin. God doesn't change. He still loves them. Verse 23 to the end of the chapter, how would you define that? It starts, who remembered us in our low estate? Strikes down the kings, but he remembered us in our lowly state, the humble. And verse 25, he provides food to all flesh. So give thanks. How, now when we look at this whole passage of creation, deliverance, God's faithful guidance in the wilderness, even when we disobey. God's remembrance of us in our lowly state. How does this apply to us? What are God's deliverances in your life? Or God's guidance in your life? Or God's protection and provision in your life? What does that mean? Do you have some stories, some examples you want to testify with the fruit of your lips? Thanksgiving? Just don't be intimidated. Oh, that it may be in the presence of his people. Just move your hand up and we'll intimidate you with a mic. No, don't be intimidated. Do you have a question, testimony, comment?
I once heard a comment that he's surprised how, when he hears the Holy Spirit, that the voice often sounds like his wife's voice. And I can kind of attest to that. When I become humble and decide to listen, God speaks to me through Livia. I hear it. I acknowledge that.
So, what are we saying about Lydia? I mean, okay, can we say that God uses our partners, our spouses in our lives, his loving kindness in that? Anybody else? Can you testify to a low time in your life? And what did God do for you? Okay, Mano.
When I was younger, I was going down the wrong path.
Here we go.
I don't want to give my whole testimony here, but when I was younger, I was going down the wrong path, and God gave me opportunity to go north when I was younger, go to First Pickle Lake and Red Lake, and that's, God used that time to bring me to a place where I would be more open or realize the path that I was going down was the wrong path, and that there was a better path. And along with that, I found my wife, and many stories to add to that, but I'll leave it there.
Okay. Yeah, you don't have to tell us every detail, but any others, deliverances or and escapes? That's the thing that comes out in the Psalms, escapes. To God alone belong the escapes from death. The shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd. Any comments? How has God provided for you?
The Psalms became very meaningful to me post-university, or like my last year, I think, when I went through something very terrifying. And at night, I didn't know what to do, except every night, I just remember during that time just repeating, because I was scared to go to sleep, Psalm 23 just became so real. And if we pick, yeah, the more we dig into the Psalms, the more comforting they are for people who are lonely or scared or in trials. Mm-hmm.
Okay. We've all had low times. Some of us maybe had very low times. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his loving kindness is everlasting. Why don't you, in what time we have left, and I'll just say we're going to stop with this section, but we shouldn't stop with thanksgiving. And Lord willing, next week we'll move into another type of psalm, and I'll try to give a little bit of a packet of those three psalms so that you can take it home with you and go over these things and questions, so when you come on Sundays you'll have had more time to think about it too and contribute. What can we learn from these things? Why don't you, like here there we have a little group already, just turn to a group of people or just for the next couple of minutes and respond, or feel free to share just how God has, you've experienced God's loving kindness in different situations of your life. Well, it won't be long, but just find the group closest to you, or make your groups.